A horror crash on Brisbane's Bayside has left a couple and their unborn baby dead and a teenage boy in custody charged with murder. Rhys D'Alessandro has the story.
Well, shocking and horrifying is how witnesses have described the scene here at Alexandra Hills. And already this morning, a makeshift memorial is forming. Locals hearing shocked, saddened at the news. A 31-year-old woman, her unborn baby and her 37-year-old partner have been killed by an out-of-control four-wheel drive and allegedly behind the wheel, a 17-year-old driver. The four-wheel drive rolled out of control after hitting a truck, and while the young couple were fighting for life, police said the driver fled the scene. He was stopped by a resident while trying to steal another car, held to the ground until officers arrived.
I've just convinced him to stay where he was with my foot a couple of times, and then he just sort of stayed there until police arrived. So
we know detectives have charged the 17-year-old driver with two counts of murder and a raft of other offences. This followed an earlier road rage incident involving the same car. Footage online showing the driver sideswiping another vehicle. A photo of what is reportedly the couple's dog is circulating on social media. They were walking their two dogs at the time. One has been found injured, the other, little Frankie, she is still missing.
I was right here and it came flying down here about 130 km. Pretty bad, it was horrific.
Tributes flowing not only here at the scene but also online. In the meantime, the 17-year-old driver is due to front Brisbane Children's Court later today.
In a bid to eliminate any fears or doubts among Australians about the COVID vaccine, the federal government is today launching a $24 million awareness campaign ahead of the planned rollout late next month. We'll go live to Canberra and our political reporter Fiona Willen. Fee, good morning to you. Where will we see these ads?
Well, Davina, they should be pretty hard to miss. So they'll be on TV, in newspapers, on social and digital media. So this is a $24 million campaign that's aiming to educate people on how the rollout will work when it begins late next month. But a key part of it is trying to get rid of some of the nervousness around the vaccine. So we understand that the government's own data has found around 3% of people are anti-vaccination. So that's not the group the government's worried about, because it's unlikely that they'd ever get a jab anyway. These ads are more targeted towards the 20% or so who are vaccine hesitant. It's thought there may be more uncertainty within that group at the moment because this is a new jab and it was created quickly. So the campaign is trying to communicate that no corners have been cut.
We only will approve vaccines when we have enough evidence that they work and that they're safe.
The rollout of the vaccines will be available in batches, so we're making sure they go to where they are needed first.
Now, Parliament isn't yet back from the summer break, but the Nationals have made it back into the headlines today. And that's because former Nationals leader Barnaby Joyce has had a go at the party's alliance with the Liberals. So he's described the coalition as a marriage of convenience, suggesting it's hurting the election chances of both parties. Now, he's complaining that the Liberals allocate all the plum gigs within the ministry to themselves and that the Nationals are left with less substantial portfolios. So this is what the current Nationals leader had to say about those remarks.
Seeing as though he used the word marriage, it's actually a marriage of strength, and we work well together. And right across the nation, Liberals and Nationals are working together to build a better Australia.
Now, Barnaby Joyce says the situation needs to be corrected before the next federal election, which could be as early as August this year. Davina?
OK, Faye, thank you. Well, it's a milestone for New South Wales, the state recording no new locally acquired COVID cases for a 10th day in a row. And in more good news, Premier Gladys Berejiklian has flagged restrictions will soon be rolled back.
I'm hoping to be able to do that tomorrow or the day after at the latest, to be able to give community that hope and confidence that we've been doing very well and we're able to take the next step.
The Premier will hold a press conference at 12:30 today. We'll have that live for our Sydney viewers. Well, former Melbourne principal Malka Leifer is set to touch down in the country after a six-year legal battle to extradite her from Israel. It comes nearly 13 years after she first fled when she was accused of sexual abuse. Christina Hearn reports.
Malka Leifer fled to Israel in 2008 just as these allegations were first aired, denying her victims their day in court. But now she must face 74 charges accused of sexually abusing three sisters when they were students at the Adas Israel School in Elsternwick. The 52-year-old was put on one of the last flights out of Israel before the airport shut because of COVID. Authorities have been tight-lipped on when she exactly will touch down here in Melbourne, but her trip, it's believed, in included stopovers in Frankfurt and Singapore. This does follow on from a six-year legal fight to get her back here to Melbourne to face those charges. It's expected that she will see out her two-week quarantine period in prison. Then she will most likely face a filing here and in front of a magistrate tomorrow or Friday via video link. She then, like any other accused person, will have the option of applying for bail.
Queensland will reportedly take control of Norfolk Island when a six-year deal with New South Wales expires in 4 months from now. The Queensland government is reportedly in talks with the Commonwealth about its plan for the remote island, which is between Australia and New Zealand. It's understood those plans include expanding health and education services. A concert to honour frontline health workers has capped off Australia Day, with some of the nation's biggest voices putting on an unforgettable show in Sydney Harbour. Emily McDonald has the story.
On the steps of Sydney's White Sails, our frontline workers receive a thank you. From the firefront and the hospital halls to the front row of Australia's most exclusive concert. Talent in the skies, the water, and on the stage. And a unique twist to one of our favourite songs. Fireworks lighting up the harbour before a special rendition of our national anthem.